Hey, gang. Hello, celestial beings. I know it's been a minute again. Life has been chaotic for all of us. If you're an American, you probably figured 2024 was going to be a bad year, or at least a really obnoxious year. And, while the same can be said for me, it's been heavier than I expected. As many of you know, if you're a longtime watcher, this last September, I lost my father, and I'm still dealing with the fallout of that. And less than a year later, within the last 30 days of when I'm recording this, I lost my grandfather as well. Needless to say, this has thrown my family into chaos, and I've had to do a lot of soul-searching. A lot of crying, and yeah, a lot of mourning. And it's times like these, and I don't know how much this will matter to some of you, but I want you to know that it's good to mourn. It's good to recognize when someone or even something of value, when it's gone, it's good to reflect on that and really consider the weight that it had in your life. And I'm saying that partly so you know that with all this loss right now, there's something else that finally ended that I'm not mourning. And honestly, I'd like to encourage you to do the same. This last week, as of when I'm recording this, the anime studio Gainax filed for bankruptcy, and I've been seeing a whole lot of people eulogizing Gainax and talking about what a shame and what a loss it is, and I'd be lying if I said there aren't a lot of titles Gainax produced that I don't just like, but love. I couldn't even fit all of them in the shot with me. But it's also times like this we really need to consider not just our relationship with brands, but how those brands or brand names treated the people that make the art we love. What I'm hoping to say to you today is that you don't just have permission not to mourn Gainax. I think it is a moral imperative that you don't. Crap, damn. Companies are not your friends. Crap, damn. Being a classic anime person, you're just kind of expected to love Gainax, and I understand why. Again, there's a lot of really great titles just right next to me, and even ones that I couldn't fit in here. Kare Kano, aka His or Her Circumstances, is such a banger. The Nadia Secret of Blue Water is a series that I still haven't watched all the way through, but it's really pretty to look at, and I certainly like a lot of the characters. Disney even plagiarized it, so it must be pretty good. And people who've been watching this channel for a long time would even notice that some of my biggest videos have been about series released by Gainax. So why is this my bugbear? Why am I so angry at Gainax? And for some of you who might be a bit more casual, you might be wondering who or what this Gainax was in the first place. Let's rewind a little bit. In the early 1980s, a group of college students from Osaka University, part of a graduating class that I like to refer to as the Osaka University Renaissance, just for how many of these artists and creatives would end up being mainstays of anime, science fiction, and tokusatsu in the decades that followed. A whole bunch of those Osaka University art kids, along with two college dropouts named
Yasuhiro Takeda
and Toshio Okada, formed a independent film group called Daikon Pictures. Daikon mostly made short animated films for science fiction conventions in Japan, copyright be damned, and they had a whole lot of fun, but eventually, at the behest of the two college dropouts, there was a push to turn this into a commercial venture. If there's one thing that they knew about, it's how much otaku, or Japanese nerds, love art that's produced by companies and love consuming it. And what if instead of focusing on selling the merchandise or soundtracks, they focused more on making money off of the anime to consume? By 1986, Daikone Pictures changed their name to Gainax and started work on their first theatrical release, The Wings of Oniamis. It was released in 1987 to critical acclaim and made basically no money. Oniamis was this artsy, sometimes extremely disturbing, but ultimately beautiful and very human science fiction film, and it might have been a little bit too heady for what Gainax was going for. And so their next release, an OVA shepherded by the great Hideaki Anno, Aim for the Top Gunbuster, would be the thing that actually put their names on the map. Gunbuster would follow a path that had been trailblazed by series like Macross, taking aesthetics from shoujo anime and mixing that in with mecha anime and the sensibilities of it, all the while also kind of being a mecha anime remake of a shoujo sports series called Aim for the Ace, which is about tennis. Absolute king shit here. This series was a massive hit, and it was basically everywhere. This was it. This was the nerds that made good. All these guys, including two college dropouts who couldn't keep their grades up because they were so focused on consuming anime and science fiction, had made their own business, and now they were making lots of money from it. See, Gainax had this image of being by otaku for otaku, and people ate that up, and what would follow would be even more legendary. For just my generation alone, Tengen Toppa Gurren Lagann and Footy Kuti are generation-defining, and both of those still pale in comparison to Neon Genesis Evangelion. But for those who might not be as into industry talk, the main thing that they associate with those series, other than out there animation and maybe being a little hornier than other shows, is that brand name, Gainax. The average fan that you run into at a convention would probably be able to tell you all of these series were produced by Gainax, but it's not as likely that they'll be able to name Hiroyuki Imaishi, Kazuya Suramaki, or even Hideaki Anno. And that feels deeply wrong to me. Let's take a brief aside and look at the MCU. After the release of the superhero film Spider-Man Far From Home, the internet became aware of something that had basically been public knowledge, but didn't feel as apparent as it did with the credits rolling on another successful Spider-Man story. See, the film rights, the character of Spider-Man, belong to Sony Pictures, the film company, whereas almost every other character in the Marvel Universe from Marvel Comics is owned by Disney, who bought the comic company several years ago. As a result, the only reason that Tom Holland's version of Spider-Man was able to interact with other characters from Disney's very popular Avengers film series was because of a deal that was cut between the two companies. Disney didn't own the film rights to Spider-Man, but they would cut a deal with Sony wherein Spider-Man was allowed to interact with characters from the Avengers, while meanwhile, in the Spider-Man films, Spider-Man and his surrounding characters could reference the Avengers characters and the events going on in the primary Marvel Cinematic Universe. When it became clear that the next outing for Tom Holland might not be able to reference or be referenced by the rest of the Avengers, people got angry. And I mean legitimately angry. I mean, like, angry enough that they took to social media and did Disney's lawyers' jobs for them without getting compensated for it. so many of these people were deeply convinced that unless Disney had the rights to Spider-Man, there was no way of getting a good Spider-Man story ever again. That was the only way to do it. It had to be because of Disney. In fact, some people straight up told me that the reason that the Tom Holland Spider-Man films were good was because of Disney. And on some ways, I empathize with where someone might have come to that conclusion. Sony's solo outings about Spider-Man's villains have been pretty laughable for the most part. Except, of course, for the Spider-Verse films, which are made by a different part of the studio anyway. But the people saying that seem to forget a whole lot of things. The creatives, the writers, the directors, the people who made Homecoming and Far From Home, those people weren't Disney employees. And those Tobey Maguire Spider-Man movies certainly weren't Disney movies. And even the entire first set of Avengers films, Iron Man, Iron Man 2, Captain America, Thor, Avengers, none of those were produced by Disney. All of them were produced before, or at least started production, before Disney had bought out Marvel and were released by Paramount. Everyone was so obsessed with the logos that they see in front of and at the end of the movie that they lost sight of the actual people making the movies. And companies count on that. They can own an intellectual property. They can't own a person. And this is why we saw things like people campaigning to get James Gunn brought back for a finale to the Guardians of the Galaxy series. This is also why more people should be campaigning for Bo DiMaio to get his job back after a phenomenal first season of X-Men 97. But we're not really here to talk about superheroes today. But we are here to talk about creatives. And yes, Disney is the biggest, most mega-sized, most evil corporation there is when it comes to managing intellectual property. But they're not the only ones doing it. How about we take a look back at Gainax? The thing about Gainax is when they wanted to get their name out there, they worked hard to get their name out there. And if that meant putting it over the creatives who were the reason their name might be out there in the first place, that's what they did. And there is one director for whom it's hard to overlook just how badly they've treated him. That is, of course, Evangelion creator Hideaki Anno. Anno was one of those Osaka University students who founded the company, and he was a major creative voice from the beginning. Like I said earlier, he directed Gunbuster, and this was when he was fresh off of being the lead animator on the God Warrior scene in Nausicaä of the Valley of the Wind. This is when he was barely a journeyman animator, just to give you an idea of how talented this man has always been. When Gunbuster took off, the real emphasis was this is a Gainax property. This is a thing that a nerd made to communicate with other nerds. And that's not even one of the more egregious examples. Anno also had a pretty amazing gig doing mechanical designs for Mobile Suit Gundam Char's Counterattack, a perennial classic and at the time was believed could be the finale to Gundam. This is pretty laughable today, but if you go back and watch that film not knowing that anything was coming afterward, I would understand you thinking that that's the end, and yeah, it's a really powerful movie. Hideaki Anno himself was the head designer on the main villain Char Aznable's flagship, the Rel Lula. But if you look at the credits of Char's Counterattack, you won't find Hideaki Anno's name anywhere. You will, however, find one very noticeable name. Gainax. Mechanical Designs by Gainax. And this would not be the last time that Anno got steamrolled by the company that he helped create. everyone thinks about Evangelion as the big Gainax series, and for good reason. Evangelion might be the most iconic anime of the entire 90s, and I don't feel like that's hyperbole, nor do I even think it's unfair. Eva's a true masterpiece. And it was deeply associated with Gainax. It still is now. In fact, I'm willing to bet you that if when you found out that Gainax had shut down, it was announced on a news article online with a picture of something from Evangelion, if not just a straight-up Evangelion poster. And that's why I think it's so important to let you know right now that Evangelion wasn't even developed in-house at Gainax. Anno and seven other Gainax employees were acting as free agents when they pitched the idea for Neon Genesis Evangelion to a TV station, and it got picked up. Unfortunately for Anno and his college friends had fallen on hard times. Gainax was never good at money. In fact, as soon as the money started flowing in, they were very bad at managing it. And while there's a lot of claims that the final episode of Gunbuster being more than half just classical music while panning over unfinished storyboards
was an artistic choice,
it seems extremely believable that the company might have just not budgeted the last episode of their OVA out and had to throw together what they could with what they had. And thankfully, because they had creative people like Hideaki Anno working on it, they were able to make it work. Now, once again, Gainax was having financial trouble and wanted to get their name out there. And sure enough, Anno, being a good college friend, wanting to help his buddies, agreed to put the Gainax branding on Evangelion. And as a result, Gainax and their four otaku, biotaku branding really leaned into merchandising Eva as much as they could. This was, of course, a big windfall for Anno in some respects. Of course, Eva was everywhere, and it raised his profile even more. But Gainax was going to keep profiting from Eva as long as they could. And eventually, this came to a breaking point. Despite Anno being a tried-and-true member of Gainax, coming back to help younger artists out, or even doing silly things like voicing a cat for Footy Cootie, Anno eventually got sick of what he was seeing. As basically soon as Eva was a hit, Gainax started getting investigated for tax evasion. And as the years went by, Anno would find himself more often than not being called back in to be a face of a professional, an adult in the room, to save face for the rest of the company when they faced other allegations of tax evasion or even sexual misconduct on the part of their leadership. Anno would continue to come back for many years until he eventually hit a breaking point. He would break off from the company and found his own company named Kara. And slowly but surely, if you're big on collecting Eva merchandise, you might notice that merch would start saying copyright Gainax and Kara, and eventually Kara and Gainax, and eventually just Kara. See, there came a point where Anno's success became something of a crutch for the people working at Gainax. They would call him up for everything. And it got to the point that Anno filed a lawsuit for complete ownership of Evangelion for a number of reasons, some being that royalties weren't being paid to him or the other people who actually made the show. But the most damning was Anno's lawyers, including the concern that a continued association with Gainax would hurt Evangelion's reputation. Despite this, Anno never really fully cut ties with Gainax, although he was very public when he got upset with them. One of the worst examples being when they took out a loan from Kara, didn't pay it back, and then Anno found out that they were selling production materials from Gunbuster that belonged to him without his permission. Let me make this entirely clear. Gainax was robbing Peter in order to keep robbing Peter. And while Gainax's treatment of Anno is certainly egregious, it's not even the only example. The Wunderkind's clique that formed Trigger were also all former Gainax employees, and this included Hiroyuki Imaishi and Yo-Yo Shinari. These Trigger employees also found themselves making art that they weren't getting royalties for. In the last couple years, the Trigger company finally wrestled the rights of Tengen Toppa Gurren Lagann and Panty and Stocking with Garter Belt away from Gainax, and that is something to celebrate. That's actually the main reason why we had those theatrical releases of the Gurren Lagann films last year. And while I'm not a big fan of the film re-edits of Gurren Lagann, I'm not gonna lie and tell you that I don't think that everyone who worked on those movies, all of Imaishi and Yoshinari's team, deserve every penny that Gainax was denying them. Unfortunately, not all of these stories have happy endings. Footy Cootie is one of the saddest ones, and while I'm going to go into that in a lot more detail in a video coming up, it's no secret that Footy Cootie was a huge hit on Cartoon Network's Adult Swim, so much so that Cartoon Network and Gainax's partner, Production IG, who co-produced the series, bought the rights out from underneath Kazuya Suramaki, despite Hideaki Anno's attempts to broker a deal that would give the rights over to Trigger. So, yay, we got Footy Cootie sequels that no one asked for. What a wonderful thing to happen to art. But that's what happens when your goal is to make money off the consumption of art rather than care about the artists. I understand how some of you might say that, well, all companies are bad at this. Intellectual property is horribly mistreated by companies, and that's true. I agree with that. But that's also the reason why I don't think we should put companies on pedestals, any companies, even if they are ones that make art that you love, because the fact of the matter is that company didn't make that art. People did. And while we're talking about the art that people make, I want to talk about the one Gainax title that I've never liked, and the recent news has made me like even less. Let's talk about Otaku no Video. Otaku no Video was an OVA that was described to me as semi-autobiographical about the creation of Gainax. And I can certainly see it. For starters, the two protagonists of the story are two college kids, both of whom drop out of school when they decide that their lives are going to be devoted not to bettering themselves or the world, but the consumption of media. It's mostly played for laughs with some truly bizarre live-action segments that are interspaced throughout. It's a really strange OVA. But the thing that never sat right with me is that these two college kids who drop out of school because consuming is more important to them, they decide to start a company. And with that company, they hope to become Otaku Kings, or Ota Kings. And these two college kids, or former college kids eventually, are so fixated on finding the next way that they're going to make lots of money that their main goal turns into finding people who can make art. Because neither of them is good at drawing. Neither of them is especially strong at writing. But they keep finding people who are. And they get them to come in and join them. But they never see them as equals. Those people, the artists who make the things that they're planning to profit off of, though they're just stepping stones. So these two can become the Ota Kings. And as the series went on for its only two episodes, I became more and more uncomfortable with the fact that not only had our protagonists decided that they were going to devote themselves to Ready Player One before there was Ready Player One, and just consuming and spitting out knowledge about art rather than engaging with it, and finding people who were talented enough to make art so they could profit off of those other people, I couldn't help but notice who was the main writer of this OVA. It was Toshio Okada, a man who to this day refers to himself as the Ota King. You might recall that it was him and
Yasuhiro Takeda
who got together all of these artists so that they could start a company to make money off content. During the bankruptcy of Gainax, Kara was actually selected to oversee the bankruptcy, and Hideaki Anno and his lawyers have made it clear that their main goal is going to be making sure royalties finally get paid to the creators of the few things that Gainax still owns the rights to. And when I look at how those creators were treated, and I think about those two college dropouts who decided they wanted to devote their life to consumption and making money off that consumption, all I see when I look back at Otaku no Video, an OVA I never liked in the first place, is a confession. And when you accept that that OVA is a confession, it's only right to conclude that it's time we start treating Gainax like the criminals they were. Rest in piss, you awful, predatory company. If you learned something about Gainax today, and maybe this changed your mind, or if you want to find out a little bit more about some other classic anime, I've got a whole lot of other things to look at. My name is Celeste, and I consider myself best. And if you'd like to support me and the things that I do, subscribing and liking are always helpful. As would be if you really want to help me, you know, pay my mortgage or buy more anime Blu-rays, you can support me on Patreon. Names of some of my supporters are coming up on the screen right now. Thank you all of you for your time, and as always, keep on spockin' in the free world.